So we have a wonderful panel for you tonight. We have Dr. Keith Witt. Keith is a licensed psychotherapist, teacher, and author who has lived and worked in Santa Barbara since 1973. Keith's work has explored integrally informed psychotherapy, intimacy, human development, spirituality, and sexuality, yielding over 60,000 therapy sessions, and I had to add these up and see if it was even possible, and it is. You've been a busy guy, Keith. So many, many therapy sessions, 7 books, 3 TED Talks, and lectures and classes which he has taught across the U.S. and Europe. He and his wife, Becky, have been together for 44 years, and they have 2 adult children, Zoe and Ethan. And I have known Keith for more years than I can even count, going all the way back to UCSB and Isla Vista and all of that. And I am so delighted that you are here tonight. This guy is truly, truly one of the good guys. So please welcome Keith Witt.
Oh, hi, everybody. I was raised by a good family in a progressive part of Los Angeles. And it was a sexist and a racist and a homophobic culture. All culture is racist and sexist and homophobic in the 50s and 60s. Kind of drove me crazy. A lot of people. And out of a lot of that came the upheavals. I became a hippie. Being a hippie was an interesting experience for me as a young white guy, because I was discriminated against. People would spit on me in marches, you know, police would arrest my friends and plant drugs on them and so on. I wanted to drop out of school and travel around the country with my girlfriend, so I had to get a job, make some money, buy a car, and so I come in here, I got some straight clothes. I went and I interviewed. I got a job with Santa Barbara Road Department. And I got the job, I was riding my motorcycle home, and I thought, you know, women can't do something and all of a sudden be part of the power group in this country. If you're black or Hispanic or Asian, you can't cut your hair and put on different clothes. Blew my mind, really. And as I became a therapist, every single person that I've ever worked with has been injured in some fashion and supported in some fashion by culture. And so all of us here, we all agree, people should have equal opportunity, and people should have equal rights, and people should have equal dignity. And I've always felt that, and my wife and I have always felt that. But you know, culture is complicated. And when I decided at a pretty young age, is that the only way out of this was to have deeper understanding about what's going on in me and in other people, especially me. And then what's my responsibility to make things change? And the hardest thing to understand is my own sexism, and my own racism, and all that stuff that arises from the deep conditioning that comes from development. And that's interesting. It's also interesting that we don't just have one culture in this country. We have lots of cultures in this country. And every single culture has healthy parts and unhealthy parts. All of them do. And there's values that a lot of them share, you know, loving children, you know, family, that kind of stuff. A lot of them have unhealthy parts. And as a therapist, people come in from whatever cultures they come in, their family culture, the culture of the family of origin, their work cultures, as you've been describing. And they all come in having been supported in some ways and oppressed in some ways. And to me, it really helps to have a historical perspective. We are in an age now, in the 21st century, that is unlike anything that humans have ever seen. You know, there's a social development that's going on. We had an agrarian society for 10,000 years. An agrarian society has slavery, it has sexism, women are property. And in the Enlightenment in the 17th and 18th century, that began to change. And the church could no longer dominate everybody, and science began to take over. That was a big deal. That's when the liberation movement started. Slavery was stopped. And the liberation movements continue to this day with gay and lesbian and with women and so on. And lots of other liberation movements. But that's not the only thing that's changed. As rationality and science took over, now there was another convulsion, and that happened in the 60s and 70s when we were beginning to bring spirit back into the world in a different way. Spiritual without religious is the fastest growing denomination in the country. And that is a reflection of something that I think is really important. We all, as we understand ourselves, we understand our wounds and the blessings that we had as men and women and so on. It begins to give us an opportunity to contribute to the culture that's emerging now, to the new age that's coming. And I'm very optimistic about it, even though I see a lot of suffering and I see people being hurt and so on. And I hear about it every day with my clients. But also I'm beginning to see something that's really interesting. People are beginning to understand that we're all unique. And this brings me to something that I wanted to mention. That I think the elephant in the room with sexism is sex. And it's especially sex education. There was an experiment that was done, not an experiment really, in the Netherlands in the 1960s. They decided to have scientifically based sex education. They looked into the research and they said, look, we're going to do this the way that the scientists have told us is the best way to do for children. They brought families in, and they had a pro-sexual education, and they taught kids about being respectful, and they taught kids about age-appropriate sex. They had family discussions and discussions at schools. They did a follow-up study 4 or 5 years later, found out that the boys and girls still thought that sex was for boys, and so they changed the education so that girls' pleasures and girls' expectations, and girls' expression and assertion needed to be important. Well, now let's fast forward to 2011. In the Netherlands, they have 1/7 the amount of abortions that we have in the United States proportionally. 1/17 the amount of teen pregnancies. 90% of those kids say the first sex that they had was with somebody they really care about. And it was a good experience. 80% of the kids in the United States say that we don't talk to our parents about sex. We had basically bad experiences, and so on. Good, thank you. Now, what's my point about this? My point is I want to look for deeper understanding, and I want to help my clients look for deeper understanding about themselves and other people. And that really begins with normalizing whoever we are. And so, if I find sexism in me, I don't want to shame myself out of existence. I want to change it. And I want to help other people change it. And if they have somebody in their family that's giving them a hard time around stuff like that, I want to help them, help that person grow. Because that's the way we're going to get out of all this. We're going to educate our children out of it, and we're going to grow out of it.